Hey everybody, this is Rod Morgenstein, and I'm on Musicians on the Record today, so hit it.
On the record, bring it on.
Can we talk about how that process started for you, Rod? The writing, the education books, and Berklee. How did you transition into that as well?
Well, I come from a family of educators. Both my parents were college professors, and I'm a schooled musician. You know, so I have a degree in performance from the University of Miami. And so at first I started writing articles for Modern Drummer, you know, when they were in their early years at the magazine, and established a nice relationship with the folks there. And then some years later, Rick Mattingly, who had been the editor of Modern Drummer, he suggested to me, he said, "Hey, you want to write a drum book together?" And we spent several years doing it. And I mean, you know, I'm happy to report that it's a very popular book. It's called The Drum Set Musician. And several years ago, Modern Drummer, you know, included it in their list of the 25 most important, you know, drum instructional books.
That's fantastic, Rod. Congratulations. Awesome.
Nice to be in the company of Stick Control.
Yes. Wow.
And syncopation, and I can't think of some of the other books.
Four-way independence and all that.
Jim Chapin.
Jim Chapin.
And so, you know, with that book, we just took an approach of, you know, let's do an introduction intermediate drum set book that, instead of just being a book filled with beats and or fills, let's teach the drum set as a musical instrument. So as a concept is introduced, there should be a piece of music with a click track for the drummer to play along with. So whether it's, where's the appropriate place to hit a crash cymbal? Well, you hit it at the beginning of a section. Well, what is a section? Well, there are verses and choruses, or 12-bar blues forms, and then there are little charts that correspond to each of these new bits of information. So,
that's great.
You know, it's very gratifying to know that many drum teachers around the world use that book with the music as part of their teaching practice. Because ultimately, if the only person who buys a drum book is a person who is a fan of the author, there's only so many fans.
Sure.
What you really want in terms of follow-through is for someone who is a drum instructor just somehow get their hands on the book.
Yes.
And if they find it a worthwhile instructional device, then they start having all of their students pick it up.
Absolutely.
And I understand, you know, drum teachers get very set in their ways, and they might just use the drum books that their teacher used with them. And so they're not always open to having to take the time to look at something new that's coming down the pipe. So, I'm very thankful that it seems to just be an ongoing thing where drum teachers are using it. So I also, some years after that came out, I was sitting at my drum pad one day, kind of warming up before I was going to sit down at my drum set. And I had this epiphany, you know, like the giant light bulb that went off, where I was looking at this slab of rubber glued to a piece of wood, and it kind of occurred to me, like, I play the drum set, like, why am I warming up on something that's not the instrument that I play? Like, does a piano player look at their piano and go, oh, I need to warm up?
Right.
A bunch of finger exercises on a table.
Right, top, yeah.
So I can then play my instrument. Or does a guitarist look for a slab of wood run their fingers on before they pick up. No, everybody warms up on the instrument.
Right.
It plays. And so I had remembered that, you know, for the past 20 years, whenever I'd have a frustration on the drum set, whether it was, you know, I'm left-handed and my right side is pathetic, so let me just do some right-hand exercises, or I feel like I'm always going around the drum set, you know, snare to the small tom, ending on the large tom. Let me go the opposite direction. Oh, let me do crisscross and upside, up and down motions, and on and on and on. Over the years, I had had all sorts of scribble on scraps of paper, different bizarre exercises that I had made up that were not rudiments, they were not beats, and they were not fills. They were exercises like scales and arpeggios and weird kinds of exercises that I remember doing when I was taking piano lessons. And so I, in that moment, sitting at the pad, you know, I was freaking out saying, I'm going to be the first drummer on planet Earth that writes a drum set warm-up book.
Wow.
Like the drum set equivalent to stick control.
Yes.
Wow. Or drum set equivalent to Hannon for piano. And, you know, so that book, it's called Drum Set Warm-Ups. And it's through Berklee, you know, it's all through Berklee, distributed by Hal Leonard. I think it's, so it's the world's first and only still drum set warm-up book. And so, you know, I do believe there's importance in sitting at a drum pad, because that's where the fingers, wrists, and arms are focused on. But when you get on the drum set, rather than just immediately go into which everybody does,
right,
you have to do a few scales and arpeggios that will kind of help you work towards the greater picture of just continually inching your technique on the drum set.
Great. Well, and you know, Christmas is coming, so I might ask Santa or the wife to get the book, because that sounds like a great thing to have. So for you at this point, with such a career that you've had and that you're teaching others, what are you actually working on or practicing on the drum kit or the pad? What challenges you still?
Well, you know what? I don't really work out of books at this point. My time is spent, one, just trying to maintain status quo.
Yeah.
Because the older you get, you know, I don't want to say gets, you know, I'm not one to say, oh my God, all the aches and pains, all this kind of thing.
Yeah.
But you know, the kind of drumming that I do is pretty hard hitting.
Sure.
And so I just have to hit the drums, maintain. I can just feel good.
Yeah.
And then the rest of the time on the drums, you know, is spent, you know, working on new drum parts for new music that will be recorded. And pretty much every year, at least one new recording is out. So like this year, we put out actually the fourth Jelly Jam recording.
Okay.
And for the first time in the band's history, we played a handful of shows in July and August. So for John Myung, the bass player from Dream Theater, it was his first time on stage playing in front of an audience with a group of musicians that were not Dream Theater.
Wow, that's fantastic.
So it was quite a thrill.
Yeah. And say the name again, Rod. It got muted out.
The Jelly Jam.
The Jelly Jam. That's the album's name.
No, that's the name of the band.
That's the name of the band. What's the name of the recording?
This new recording is called Profit, and it's P-R-O-F-I-T, which is crossed out and replaced. No, it's P-R-O-P-H-E-T, crossed out and spelled P-R-O-F-I-T.
Nice.
And the artwork is so cool. It's like a, you know, a Middle Ages monk lit from above. You don't see a face. And the monk is holding scales. And in one side of the scale is the earth. And in the other side of the scale is a gold bar.
Yeah.
And the question is, which is going to win out, greed or humanity?
Yeah,
you know?
Right. So, big question really, right now, right? Yeah.
Really cool record. And not so much on this album, but on certain songs on previous albums, we wrote them around drum grooves that I create on my rides to and from Boston. Wow. I have like 5 hours to go each way.
Yeah.
So I'll set the cruise control and start drumming on the steering wheel and the floor.
That's great.
It's amazing what can come.
Absolutely. Just from driving, right?
Yeah.
You mentioned your evolution as far as with drumming and just some of the physical stuff that as drummers we can have or feel. Ever any injuries for you from drumming?
I have never had an injury from drumming.
Yeah.
I've had a couple of really interesting years the past 2 years. About 2 years ago, I slipped down some stairs during a beautiful snowfall where I forgot there was ice underneath the snow.
Mm-hmm.
So ouch. I went up, and when I came down, it was on my left side. So I slammed my left shoulder and my left thigh.
Mm-hmm.
And to make a long story short, it turned out to be a torn rotator cuff.
Oh, no. Mm.
One of the four tendons fully torn. But just want to put this out there to anyone that may suffer through this. I went to an orthopedic surgeon who told me my only option is surgery. And when I went for a second opinion, a procedure called PRP, that stands for plasma-rich platelets, was presented to me, and it's where they take blood, run it through a centrifuge, and by using ultrasound to target where the tear is, they shoot the platelets into that area, and there's a very high success rate where it causes the severed tendon to literally grow back together.
Wow, amazing.
And you know, this is the arm where I was at a point where if I tried to lift my arm or go around the kit and hit a floor tom, I would scream bloody murder.
Yeah, painful.
It was, oh my God, the instant that I would constantly forget, like, don't do that, unimaginable.
Yeah.
And it's 100% healed.
Amazing.
So, so you might not have to go for surgery, which will be debilitating for a minimum of 6 months.
Right, that's what I've heard. Yep.
Pick up a stick.
Yeah.
So that was an incredible outcome. It's not recognized in this country, so it's like a cash procedure.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So PRP.
PRP.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I handed over $1,000 cash for like an 80 or 90% chance of healing.
Mm.
And to me, it was well worth the money to give it a shot. The other thing that I suffered through, which I have to say was even worse.
Oh, no.
Has nothing to do with drumming.
Yeah.
Kidney stones.
Ah, yeah. That certainly can affect drumming, though, can it, right?
Well, it affected me to the point that it was a 20-day ordeal with three attacks.
Mm.
And the second attack hit me on the fourth day when I was flying for 9.5 hours from Boston to meet Winger.
Oh, no.
Salt Lake City. And I went through a 9-hour kidney stone attack.
Wow.
Flying.
Yeah, brutal.
And I ended up in a Salt Lake City hospital for 5 days.
Wow.
We were just so fortunate that one of our stage crew guys is a drummer and filled in for me for 3 shows that weekend.
Wow.
Then 2 shows for me the next weekend.
Mm.
You know, I had to have a lithotripsy, which is where they blast the stones. And then that made things worse. So I had to have a stent, like a 12-inch stent insert, which I have inside for 10 days, and then I had a third surgery to have it removed. It's like a black comedy.
Yeah.
Story.
Yeah.
Most intense pain I've ever experienced in my life.
I could imagine. Sounds debilitating. Yeah.
Even more than the arm. Way sure. more than the arm. Because the arm thing, if I would remember, don't do this and don't do that.
Yeah, right, right. Yeah.
It would be okay.
Yeah. That just hurt all the time, sounds like.
Yes.
Yeah.
But I've never had a direct injury from playing drums other than, you know, slamming a finger.
Yeah.
Right? Because the other hand is underneath.
Sure.
Snare drum.
Yeah.
Or having a fingernail go into a cymbal a little bit too far.
Right.
Or having a drumstick almost take an eye out, but not quite.
Okay. Yeah. So some bumps and bruises, but nothing huge around that. Yeah.
Getting hit by a sneaker from a fan, a drunk fan,
okay.
at an outdoor festival, flinging it.
Okay. Comes with the territory, I guess, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm wondering that a couple of more questions then, Rod, and thank you for your generosity with your time.
Sure.
And first of all, you know, congratulations. I'm not sure you realize, but you are up for Modern Drummer's Legend category this year, along with guys like Peter Erskine and Clyde Stubblefield. And so congratulations on just being nominated for that. That's fantastic.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Absolutely, absolutely.
I was, yeah, definitely taken aback when I was informed of that.
Yeah, that's quite
it. I think the voting ended. I forgot to vote.
Okay. Who would you have voted for?
Yeah, right. Well, yeah, I mean, I don't know how you vote.
Right. Yeah.
Kind of, you know, Peter Erskine is one of my favorite jazz drummers.
Yeah.
Oh my God, I'm so embarrassed. Cause I can't remember. I see the face.
Yeah.
David Garibaldi.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
One of the great, great funk drummers.
Right.
You know, Harvey Mason, just one of the great pocket
yeah.
studio players.
Yeah.
You know, Clyde Stubblefield, you know, reggae. So
yeah.
It's sort of like you're, you know, it's one from category A, one from
yes.
category B, C, D. Yeah.
Right. And I was wondering, you know, you mentioned those names and we talked about the Beatles being an inspiration. Who are some of your favorite, you know, inspirational musicians, both drummers and non-drummers?
Well, you know, the drummers that changed my life after Ringo were Mitch Mitchell from Jimi Hendrix.
Yeah, you bet.
You know, like the granddaddy of fusion.
Yeah, yeah.
Music. You know, nice. Obviously an accomplished jazz drummer being yeah. thrown into this whole new
right.
rock world.
Yeah.
Ginger Baker.
Yeah.
The Cream, another yeah. jazz drummer doing his
yes.
thing.
Yeah. yeah.
In the power trio.
Yeah.
Led Zeppelin.
Mm-hmm.
About everybody in Led Zeppelin. Every one of those four guys.
All virtuosos, right?
Yeah, Robert Plant, I'd have to say is my favorite. Mm-hmm. Favorite singer.
Mm-hmm. There we go. Yeah.
Jethro Tull and Clive Bunker, the original drummer. He was a yeah. huge inspiration for me.
Nice.
He came to a drum clinic years later that I did.
Is that right?
In England. I was so starstruck.
Yeah.
You know, it's amazing when you meet people who changed your life
yeah.
when you were young.
Sure.
You know, Jethro Tull hit the scene, I think maybe around 1969. I was like 15 or 16.
Yeah.
And so then to meet people.
Yeah. Absolutely.
See at that age. It's amazing.
Yeah.
Tony Williams.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Amazing jazz drummer.
Sure.
The sound of his ride cymbal.
Yeah.
The Miles Davis records that he played on and the Kilimanjaro Miles Davis record.
Mm.
Phenomenal, phenomenal. You know, and then after Tony Williams, then I was now. Oh, and then Billy Cobham.
Yeah,
went to the orchestra. And
yeah.
certainly, Billy, he was really like the first person who came from the jazz world that brought this. I can't really say he came from the jazz world because he was in a band, the Dreams.
Mm-hmm.
But he was in a band that was the first incredible jazz group that
yeah.
used you know, the hard hitting of rock and the loud nastiness of rock.
Yeah.
It's like just the perfect blend. That music turned my life upside down. I couldn't get it.
Right.
Yeah. Then I'd have to say those are the guys who really did it. And then, you know, since then, there've literally been dozens of players who, when I hear them play, you know, they bring me to another place. Richie Hayward from Little Feat.
Mm, sure.
Had a feel unlike nobody to me. Peter Erskine's touch, magnificent. Mm-hmm. There's so many, you know. Vinny Caliuta, Steve Smith, Danny Gottlieb.
Yeah.
And I'm in total awe of the generation of players who've come up in the last 10 or 20 years who've been stretching the technique envelope to places I never thought imaginable.
Right. Who are some of those guys that your favorite players or who inspire you like that?
I mean, the guys that are coming to mind are like, you know, Virgil Donati, mm-hmm. Thomas Lang, Marco Miniman, Mike Mangini, you know, the guys doing that sort of thing. As a spectator, I appreciate it just imagining the untold thousands and thousands of hours that it took to be able to achieve some of those things, because they don't seem humanly possible.
Right. Yeah. It's quite machine-like, but you see a human being doing it, right? Especially like with Thomas Lang and Virgil Donati. Those guys are amazing. Yeah.
And in fact, you know, it's funny. I remember the first place I heard Virgil's name spoken was on the phone by Dom.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He called me up as I was getting ready to go to Australia and New Zealand to do drum clinics. Mm-hmm. He said, "Rod, I heard you're on your way out the door to fly overseas."
Yeah.
I said, "Yeah." He said, "I just have two words for you." I said, "What?" And he said, "Virgil Donati." This is 1994.
Yeah.
I said, "Well, what does that mean?" He said, "Call me when you get home."
Right. That's great. Yeah.
Yeah. So, so when I finally met Virgil, it was at a drum festival in a beautiful theater in Melbourne, Australia, for a drum store called Drum Tech, and a lovely guy owned the store. And I'm having trouble with names.
That's fine. Yeah.
Because I see his face too, just this sweetheart of a guy, Frank Corniola.
Yes. Yeah.
And so there were so many incredible players that day, and it was a very long event, probably from noon to 9 o'clock that night. Mm-hmm. And so Frank Corniola suggested that, although I was the international clinician of the day, he said, "Do you mind going on second to last? Because we have a drummer by the name of Virgil Donati." I said, "Oh, there's the two words."
Yeah, yeah.
It was like the Buddy Rich of Japan, of Australia, and he's going to be playing with his band.
Wow.
And you're just going to be out there with a drum set, maybe playing to a track or whatever. I said, "Sure." So I did my thing, and it was fun. Mm. Right? And then I watched Virgil, you know, tear the house down.
Right.
It was the first time I had seen some of those super drumming technical things ever.
Yeah.
Mm. And before he went on, you know, he said hello and he said, "Hey, you know, my band knows a couple of Dixie Dregs, Steve Morse."
Very cool.
"For the encore to close down the show, you want to drag your drum set back out here? We'll double drum them." So I said, "Sure."
That's great.
Then I watched him play and went, "Oh my God, I have second thoughts about this."
Right.
One of the songs that we played was a Steve Morse band song called Cruise Missile, which is a fast double bass shuffle.
Okay.
And I made the mistake when Virgil looks over at me, you know, 20 feet away and says, "How fast do you want to play it, Rob?" I made the mistake of saying, "Hey, man, it's your show."
Right.
He counted the band in way faster than we had ever played it.
Yeah.
So 10 seconds into the song, I was huffing and puffing and praying to a higher power to get me through.
Absolutely.
For anyone who's ever played a double bass shuffle, the way mortals play it is you shuffle the feet going and you strategically place a ghost stroke in between the first and third triplet. So it ultimately sounds like and when you get it going fast, it sounds like God knows what the tempo marking was.
Right, right, 220 or something, right?
I'm just trying to get the ghost stroke in between the...
Yeah.
And I look over at Virgil, and he's going... You know, with his feet.
Yeah.
And so casual and like, you know, twirling sticks and
right.
Amazing. Sound. But you know, just a word of advice to everybody out there: smile for the camera, and your audience won't have any idea what's going on. Because you know, in the case of two drum sets going, if both guys or girls or guy are flailing their arms and making crazy faces.
That's right.
All that's coming out of the PA system is a barrage of of notes. And so no one's going to know that you're freaking out or that anything's wrong as long as you smile for the camera. That's and you know, ultimately it was great.
Yeah. Yeah. Nobody can tell. Yeah.
No one can and so that's, you know, that is the day that I met Virgil Donati. And you know, legend had it, maybe Dom had mentioned it to me, that this guy, he practices from morning till night, and he doesn't even take a break for lunch. He keeps his feet going while he sets his sandwich and milk and chips on his floor. And I went, yeah, right. Well, wouldn't you know it, the next day, you know, I happened to come by the drum shop, and Virgil was practicing, but I only heard the feet. So I kind of just cracked the door a little bit so I could look in, and there he was eating his sandwich and chip while his feet.
Still practicing.
Yeah. Well, you know, where there's a will, there's a way. He decided early on that he wants, you know, the world to know what he's made of.
That's right.
He's always been at the top of that technical side of drumming game. He's a great drummer all around.
Right.
Aside from that, but
yeah,
I've also had to do some clinics with him, and oh my goodness.
Definitely inspiring, right?
Yeah.
So I'm wondering for you, Rod, if your music, if your playing could have one effect on the world, what would you want that effect to be?
The effect, well, I just would hope that I move some people, you know, and put them in that good place, whether they're a musician or not, put them in that place that musicians are lucky enough to get to now and then. I don't know. You're a drummer, I assume?
Yes, I am. Yes.
All right. So have you ever had a moment where you're playing and you come back to consciousness and say, oh my God, where was I?
Oh yeah.
For the previous second or five seconds.
Right, yes.
Because I want to go back to that because all of the cares or pressures of life just went away for that moment. I was in that good, maybe, you know, it's what, you know, in certain meditations they call cosmic consciousness.
That's right.
So on occasion it happens for me. So it would be wonderful knowing that, you know, that someone who's come to see me perform at one event or another, whatever it is, it's concert or a clinic, has had a moment where they've just had a smile in their face going, God, I'm really glad I'm here than anywhere else, you know?
Absolutely.
And to me, one of the nicest compliments I've received at times over the years is when someone says, you know what, Rod, you're like a really musical drummer. Mm-hmm. You're like a sensitive player.
Yeah.
Or you're dynamic.
Yes.
And to me, I find that really special because drummers can have a tendency to just hit the drums really hard And if they're not hitting hard enough, they hit harder.
Right.
And there's a big dynamic range that's just sitting there for us to use. Yeah. And if you hit a drum really quietly, when you then hit the drum really loud, it's going to have so much more impact than if you just come out of the gate, bam!
Right. You know? There's much more to the instrument than just hitting hard.
There is, and you know, I'm guilty of it. As
oh, me too.
Other people like that. When someone's watching us play, we feel that we have to fill up every space.
Yeah.
Because the silence can be deafening and scary,
right.
But silence can be so incredible because of the things that follow. So, it's the space that we leave among the notes that we're playing that kind of make the whole package cool.
Right, right. And two more questions, Rod. Is it okay to ask you about some of the gold records behind you? Yeah, I'd love to hear about some of the stories about some of the gold records behind you. I think it's great to have that in the background. And clearly, you've earned them. So what do we got there?
Well, let's see. These are gold and platinum albums for the first two Winger records.
Awesome.
So the Winger, the first album was just called Winger, and the second album was called In the Heart of Young. So the first album got close to being double platinum, which means close to selling 2 million copies.
Nice.
The first album didn't do quite as well. Second album didn't do quite as well as the first.
Okay.
But is substantially.
Yeah.
A million seller.
Yeah.
And both of those records went gold in Japan and Canada.
Nice.
It was an incredible period of time, like a 3-4 year period for me, having spent 11 years in the fusion world, where the Dixie Dregs garnered so much respect in the music community, and it put us all on the map, showing up in the different magazine polls.
Yeah.
On respective instruments, and the six of our albums were nominated for Best Instrumental, Rock Instrumental Recording, Grammys.
That's great.
But with Winger, I got to see it from the record sales.
Yeah, more of that commercial success.
The commercial success, and anybody that, that kind of, poo-poos the commercial success of a musician doesn't fully understand the reality of how anything works. Because I would hear it from some Dregs fans.
Mm.
They found out that I was now out of the fusion world and in the hair band world or the hard rock world.
Yeah.
You hear the word, I guess he sold out for the money.
Right, yeah.
But the reality is, just because you decide to play in a band that has a vocalist, it doesn't ensure any record sales.
That's right. That's right.
Even back then, most of the bands that got signed didn't sell any records, and you never even heard of them.
Yeah.
It was gone. Unless a few lucky breaks
happened
for those bands, nothing happened. And fortunately, all of the stars lined up for Winger, and it happened. But I learned so much seeing how that side of the business works.
Sure.
When a record label thinks they have something, that can really seal the deal for them.
Yes.
Because the record labels that had the Dixie Dregs, they knew, business wise, that no matter how big an instrumental band gets, it's not going to sell millions of records.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It might reach a lot of musicians, but at the end of the day, if we could sell 100,000 records, that is a massively huge success.
Absolutely, absolutely.
But with it, once you add the vocals to it, the potential for your audience grows by leaps and bounds. But just to think, because you add vocals to it, that you're going to sell records.
Right.
That's laughable. It's immature thing.
Absolutely, yeah, and that's been happening for a long time. When Dylan went electric, they said he sold out, right? So,
I remember that. Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Positively 4th Street.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
My nerves.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. So wait. See, there's there's the Dregs Grammy nominations.
Nice.
That side.
Yeah, let me switch the camera right to you. That's fantastic.
That, yeah, those are
beautiful. Whoops. Awesome.
So, I like to refer to myself as a six-time Grammy loser.
Right, but at least you got nominated, right? That's pretty cool. More than a lot of folks get, right? So in closing then, Rod, for you probably talk a lot about this with your students at Berklee too. For musicians who are watching this in the future and who want to have a great career like yours and maybe get a couple of those gold or platinum things on their wall, what's some of the advice that you would tell musicians coming up?
If you speak to anyone who has had a career where they've made their living in music, they will each tell you about their life-changing moments. Mm. And so, like I spoke about earlier, we had no way of knowing that a famous musician would just stumble into a club one night to have a beer and then love the band he was watching, and because of him, turn us on or turn the record label that his band was on to this band he just saw, and then we got a record deal.
Yes.
The thing is, luck favors the prepared. Mm-hmm. You don't know if today is the day you're going to be walking down the street and bump into a famous person who could change your life. Mm-hmm. And the last thing you want is to not be on your game, on your instrument, when those moments present themselves. So try to sit at a drum, if you're a drummer, try to sit at a drum set. Mm-hmm. Day of your life, if only but for a few moments, just so that being a drummer becomes a natural extension of who you are as a person, the complete you.
Yeah.
And make every effort to be seen and heard as much as possible.
That's great.
You know, so practice. You don't have to practice, you know, insanely, but enough to where you're feeling good that if at any moment you have to sit down somewhere to play, you can play. Right. And if you have a band, get your band out there playing in front of people. The thing is, you know, if you have to believe strongly in the band that you're with. Mm-hmm. This is I'm not talking about if you're just playing drums and you want people to know who you are so you could get a gig. Mm-hmm. If that's the case, you have to find out in your town about all the places where there's open mic night so you could sit in and be playing so that you can start, you know, kind of circulating so that people start talking about you.
Yeah.
But if you have a band, the band has to start really honing its live performing chops by getting out there and playing. There's no money in it, so forget that.
Right.
It's not about that at all. You're just trying to move things along. Mm-hmm. And if there are clubs or theaters or just venues, where you live that have national acts coming in, use your demo or a YouTube video or whatever you have to give to the people who promote the shows in those venues so that maybe you can get an opening slot.
Yeah.
You know, the more of an audience you can begin to cultivate, it makes you more attractive to record labels taking an interest in you.
Yeah.
It's not an easy road. But to me, it's a road worth pursuing if you're, you know, feeling it so strongly inside. And I know, I see it every day with the students that I teach at Berklee. I see myself from when I was a student. There's this burn going on inside where I have to make it. I have to, you know, I have to do music at all costs.
Right.
And so give it a shot.
Rod Morgenstein, thank you so much for your time, and thank you for being on the record with us.
My pleasure. This was wonderful. Thanks.
Yeah, fantastic. Thank you, Rod. I really appreciate it. That's my time with great drummer Rod Morgenstein. Loved the stories about being in the studio and the ghost notes, being out on tour in front of 50,000 people, and all of the inspirational advice for up-and-coming musicians. I'd love to hear what you thought of it. Please connect with me on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram, and check out musiciansontherecord.com. Until next time,
I'm your host, David Ward, for Musicians on the Record.